Tantor Audio presents Lady Protector by L.E. Modesitt, Jr. Narrated by Kyle McCarley. 1. And that I will employ all talent and skills necessary to do so, at all times and in all places, so that peace and prosperity may govern this land and her people. As the words of the ancient oath she had taken as Lady Protector died away, making her the first Lady Protector since Mykel the Great had created the office of Protector of Lanacrona hundreds of years earlier, Mykella stood for a moment looking out across the courtyard of the palace in Tempra. She had almost forgotten the remainder of the investiture ceremony. Almost. With only a slight hesitation, she walked down the steps, past the bodies of her immediately deceased Uncle Joramil and Cousin Baronet, their figures sprawled across the stone. Under-Commander Erased followed Mykella closely. On the left side, at the bottom of the five low and wide stone steps leading up to the main entry of the palace entry, lay the body of Arms Commander Nefrit, who, less than a fraction of a glass before, had tried to cut her down with his saber. One of the southern guards had straightened his form and laid him out on his back, facing the palace. Beyond the body, a southern guard stood, holding the reins of the gray stallion that had been Joramil's. Before she mounted the stallion, Mykella turned to Erased.
Have the bodies prepared for a quiet family memorial. There will be no procession and no honors for any of them.
She almost added,
Traitors do not deserve honors of any sort.
She did not. That would have made her look weak before the still assembled southern guards.
Have someone guide my sisters to the Lady Protector's study and provide a guard. I will see you there.
Erased nodded.
Yes, Lady Protector.
She could sense a certain amusement behind his words, but also approval. She couldn't help but wonder what she had forgotten. With her talent shield still tight about her, she swept the black cloak back over her shoulders, revealing the brilliant blue vest of the heir and the black night silk shirt and trousers she almost always wore. Then she mounted, wishing that she were taller and that she didn't have to jump to place her black boot in the stirrup. She wasn't about to ask for a leg up. She never had before, and now that she was the ruler of Lanacrona, she wasn't about to begin. As she turned the stallion toward the east, before riding to the end of the palace, then north and out of sight to the rear courtyard, she used her talent to extend her hearing, trying to pick up any words that might bode ill. Over the sound of hooves on the stone pavement that showed no sign of wear, even after thousands of years, she began to hear murmurs.
Rides like a god.
Never thought the daughter.
The one Celtier looked to fill his breeches.
Had that been Mollerick, the envoy from Southgate, or one of the local Celtiers from Tempra? Either way, that suggested problems, not that there wouldn't be scores of them in the days ahead. Her eyes flicked to the massive oblong structure that was the palace. Not for the first time, she wondered what function it had served in the days of the vanished electors who had built it, because the interior was anything but designed for a ruler, even with all the additions, such as the kitchens, made over the years. After she reached the rear courtyard, she turned the stallion toward the middle rear door to the palace. Two southern guards looked blankly from the stallion to her, clearly not expecting the daughter of the former Lord Protector.
A few things have changed, she said as she reined up. Lord Joramil was executed for poisoning my father and plotting the death of my brother. So was his son. That left me as Lady Protector, and the Celtiers and the Southern Guards have affirmed my succession.
The younger guard swallowed hard. The older and graying guard nodded slowly.
We have always served your family, Lady. We will continue to do so.
Mykella could sense the honesty behind the words.
Thank you.
She dismounted gracefully, handed him the reins, stepped back, then turned toward the door.
She'd do that,
she heard the younger guard say as she opened the door.
She was named after Mykel the Great. For good reason, it appears.
As she closed the palace door behind her, she certainly hoped so, but put that thought aside as she hurried along the wide interior corridor, following it west, then south, and finally east to reach the central stone staircase, wide as it was, the only staircase, to the upper level of the palace. At the base of the steps were two southern guards, both older rankers rather than the interior palace guards she had known. That Erased had made that change did not surprise her, but the speed with which he had acted did. It also pleased her. The one on the left inclined his head.
Lady Protector?
Mykella returned the nod and hurried up the stairs. Neither guard spoke again, even after she passed them. Another pair of southern guards were stationed at the top. She nodded to both and turned to her left. In moments, she had reached her destination. For just a moment, she hesitated. Was it still sexy? Her father's memorial ceremony, just yesterday, seemed far longer than a day ago. She straightened and opened the door. Chalmer rose from behind the table desk in the outer anteroom that guarded the entry to the study that had been her father's.
Lady Protector.
Mykella almost smiled.
Who told you?
Under Commander Erased sent a southern guard to inform me. He has also placed trusted guards in places in the palace.
I know.
She didn't mention how she'd discovered that.
The commander is quite able and very loyal.
She paused and looked at Chalmer.
How did you feel about my father's death and Joromil's efforts to become Lord Protector?
I was distressed, Lady. I cautioned your father about Lord Joromil once. The second time I brought up the matter, he told me never to mention the subject again if I wanted to remain as his private scrivener.
The gray-haired functionary smiled sadly. Mykella could sense the truth of the older man's feelings.
Then you will serve me as loyally as you did him?
If you will have me, Lady Protector.
I will. But only if you remain honest, and tell me of your misgivings about any action I may take or contemplate.
Chalmer bowed deeply.
That I will, Lady.
He straightened.
Your sister Salia is already awaiting you in the study.
Do you know where Rachelona is?
She is in her chamber. A pair of southern guards are posted there to keep others from intruding. The undercommander said that she was not to leave the palace without your permission.
That is correct. Matters need to settle for a time.
When Mykella stepped through the inner door, Salia was standing to one side of the desk in the study that had always been that of the Lord Protector of Lanacrona, a study that had become Mykella's as the first Lady Protector of the land. Behind the outward poise of her tall, blonde, and beautiful youngest sister, Mykella could sense confusion, apprehension, and even some fear. Given Salia's expertise and training with weapons, that fear surprised Mykella.
There's no reason for you to worry now,
Mykella said.
You can sense that too, can't you?
When people are close.
With what you did, why couldn't you save Father?
Salia's voice was not quite accusatory.
I couldn't learn what I learned fast enough.
Mykella shook her head.
The things I did today. Some of them. Today was the first time I did them, at least in public.
But some of them she'd only tried once before, and all of them, except seeing the Soarer, using the table in the depths of the palace's lower levels, and beginning to sense what people felt, she had been forced to learn in order to survive after her father's poisoning by Joramil.
Until I did them today.
She shrugged, a gesture between resignation and helplessness.
You know I tried to caution Father, and warn him.
Did you have to kill Baronet?
Yes. He was weak, and Chelezar would have manipulated him. She might even have married him. She's that calculating.
Before Mykella could say more, there was a rap on the study door.
Lady Protector, Under Commander Erased.
Have him come in.
The broad-shouldered and blonde Erased stepped into the study and immediately bowed.
Lady Protector.
As he straightened, his pale green eyes met those of Mykella. She could sense a firm resolve, as well as concern for her. That boded well, since she'd named him as both arms commander of Lanacrona and her designated heir. She could also sense the thin strand of green amid the golden brown of his unseen life thread, a thread that seemed more vital than that of Salia's, and far more than that of Chalmer, whose thread was almost yellowish-brown, stretching invisibly out to the east. Erased extended his hand, palm up. In it was a ring, golden, with a large square-cut emerald set in the middle of the seal of Lanacrona.
This was your father's. The usurper wore it. It is yours now.
Both seeing her father's seal ring and hearing Erased calling her uncle a usurper jolted Mykella, but she nodded as she took the ring.
Thank you.
Because it was far too large to fit any of her fingers, she slipped it into her belt pouch.
It is yours by right,
Erased said quietly.
It is the Lady Protector's by right,
Mykella said gently.
Not mine.
Erased nodded. Mykella sensed his approval of her words, even as she thought for a moment. Although she had planned carefully the steps by which she had removed her uncle Joramil and his son Baronet after their all-too-successful efforts to kill her father and her brother Jerixilt, she really hadn't planned beyond stopping her uncle from taking control of Lanacrona.
Commander Erased,
she began, looking into his pale green eyes.
What sort of document or proclamation do we need to confirm you as arms commander of Lanacrona?
A simple statement with the Lord Protector's... the Lady Protector's signature and seal, Lady Mykella.
I'll also need your recommendations for the officers to take your place and that of Commander Demel in the Southern Guards.
I would recommend Major Choalt as commander, but he will have to be recalled from Supat.
Erased paused.
We should discuss the position of under-commander now that Commander Demel has... departed.
For the moment, I assume you and... other officers you trust can handle the combined duties. Will that be a problem?
No, lady.
A faint smile crossed Erased's lightly tanned face. I will dispatch a courier to recall the Major immediately.
I also need to deal with Chelezor.
Confine her,
suggested Salia. Erased nodded. Mykella looked to the arms commander.
Would you have a squad escort her here to see me? Can you also spare a squad to keep anyone from removing anything from the villa? It's not personal property, but belongs to the Lord or Lady Protector.
Those matters I can and will attend to. Pardoning my forwardness, lady, both would be good ideas. If you would excuse me. Mykella nodded.
If you would keep me informed as to your whereabouts after dealing with Lady Chelezar.
I will do so. Erased paused. I'll also have Captain Maletor report here in case anything else comes up where you may need the Southern Guards.
That would be good.
Mykella smiled ruefully. She should have thought of that. At least she'd been intelligent enough to involve Erased.
You may go.
With a nod, the commander departed. His brevity and haste told Mykella she should have thought of putting Chelezar under guard even sooner, but it was less than half a glass after she'd become Lady Protector, and dealing with her late uncle's wife hadn't been her highest priority. She almost shook her head. Now, there could be no excuses.
Only mistakes when you fail to act as necessary.
Once Erased had left the study, Mykella turned back to Salia.
I still need to talk to Rachel on her.
She won't want to talk to you,
predicted Salia.
She's convinced that she was in love with Baronet and that he loved her. You've ruined everything for her. She thinks you did it out of spite and greed. She said that you've always wanted to rule after father.
I kept her alive. Chelezar would have poisoned her again before long, or done something else equally fatal in order to keep Baronet from marrying her.
She won't believe that, Mykella. She never will.
You do, don't you?
Salia offered a sad smile.
I wasn't sure for a long time. I thought you were right, but that was more because I trusted you. Now, people can't lie to you, can they?
They can lie all they want, and some still do.
That's not what I meant. You've changed. Did you know that I danced with that Defoyon Major?
No, you didn't mention it.
He asked a lot of questions about you.
From her one dance with Major Smalltalk, Mykella had no difficulty believing that.
And?
He said that no one could deceive you. He also said that such a trait was admirable and useful in a ruler, but for anyone else it led to great pain and chaos. It already has, hasn't it?
Salia's voice was gentle.
What else would you have had me do?
Knowing you, there weren't any other choices.
A hint of bitterness lay behind the words, softly as they had been spoken. Mykella walked toward the wide window that looked out on the front courtyard, still filled with the weak sunlight of a late afternoon in the middle 10 days of spring, scarcely any warmer than winter. Was Salia right? Had all the deaths that she had already created, both directly and indirectly, been unavoidable just because of who she was? How many others would there be?
You can't stop now,
Salia said.
Then all of it will have been for nothing.
Her sister's words brought her up short, with the suggestion that there was still more to do. Of course there was, but
what have you forgotten? Who else was part of Joromil's plots?
Abruptly, she stiffened. How could she have forgotten the lizardly Maximt, who had replaced poor Kiedren as the head finance clerk? That reminded her that she needed to have someone track down Kiedren's family and allow them to return to Tempera. She also needed to make sure they received the stipend Kiedren would have received if Joromil had not forced the poor clerk to suicide. As soon as practicable, she needed to talk to Lord Garrick and all the other ministers who had served her father. And what about Tregget, the healer? How much had he known, or suspected, about the poisonings? She turned back to Salia.
Have you seen Tregget recently?
No.
Salia frowned.
Why?
I need to talk to him.
Do you think...
I don't know. I need to find out.
She turned as there was another knock on the study door. She sensed Chalmer outside, along with another man.
Yes?
The private scrivener eased the door open slightly.
Captain Mailtor is standing by, Lady Protector. Do you have any orders for him?
I do, if you would have him come in.
Mykella walked from the window back to a position before the carved desk that held so many memories, all centered on her father. Chalmer opened the door wider and gestured to the officer. Mailtor was a captain Mykella did not recognize, barely half a head taller than she was, and that meant he was indeed short for an officer, but with broad shoulders and a muscular build. He carried his cap under his arm, and his face was olive-tanned under black hair. He inclined his head respectfully, then straightened, his black eyes alert.
Lady Protector.
Captain, I don't recall seeing you here before.
No, lady. I've just been promoted from under-captain, and I was passing through before taking up a new post with 5th Company in Dekron.
Mykella nodded, then spoke.
There are a few other tasks that need to be taken care of. I'd like you to have some men take Maximt into custody. He is the head clerk of the Finance Ministry, and that study is at the far end of the north corridor on this level of the palace. It should be open, but Chalmer will have a key. I'd also like you to see if someone can locate the healer Tregit so that I might talk to him.
Yes, Lady Protector. Is there anything else?
Not for the moment, Captain. I'm afraid there will be, though.
Mailtor nodded, then turned and departed, closing the study door behind him.
Maximt won't be there, Mykella predicted. Neither will Tregit.
If either saw what you did on the steps, said Salia, they'll be on their way to the Iron Valleys, or taking a boat across the river to Squat Country.
There are others I won't see again either, mused Mykella, and that alone will tell me who else was with Joromil.
Or those who believe you will think that,
pointed out Salia.
That's all too possible. Some of them may even be guilty.
Mykella took a deep breath.
For the moment, will you take over running the palace? I know that's not something...
Salia smiled.
I can do that. Chatelaine Aurelia will be more than glad to tell me if I'm about to make a mistake.
Her smile widened into a brief grin that quickly faded.
Only for a while.
Mykella paused.
In a few days, when the worst settles down, you can...
She stopped. Salia was shaking her head.
Things will settle down. They'll never be the same, though.
You won't ever have to go to Southgate. Ever. Or any place else.
Mykella. Sooner or later, I'll have to go somewhere if I want to have a life of my own. We both know that.
Later doesn't mean sooner. If you want to be matched, he will have to meet your approval in person, and mine. You can also have the choice not to choose.
Thank you. It would be nice to have some choice, or not to be forced into choosing. What about you? You're going to take the commander, aren't you?
That's possible. I haven't said anything.
He'd be a fool to refuse.
That's why I haven't said anything.
Salia merely nodded, but Mykella could sense a certain amusement behind her sister's pleasant expression. Mykella paused. What else could she say?
Would you mind checking on Rachel, Anna?
I can do that.
Mykella watched as her youngest sister slipped out of the study.
What if Ares turns out not to care for me?
She didn't think she'd misread his interest, an interest that she had sensed months before. But
what if it's only interest, and not much more?
After she had set Chalmer to drafting the documents promoting Choalt and Ares, Mykella was still pondering over all the difficulties that lay before her when Salia returned more than a half glass later.
What did she say? She didn't want to talk to me. She'd bolted the door.
I talked to the door, and finally she let me in when I asked if she wanted the entire palace to hear what I had to say.
She wasn't happy. She's been crying all the time since the ceremony.
It's all my fault, of course.
Mykella, what you did was necessary, but it is your fault.
So it would have been better for Father's poisoning and Jerexilt's planned accident to go unnoticed? For Joromil to seize the office of Lord Protector, all so that she could marry Baronet? So that I could be hurried off to Derica, and you could be matched to the son of a spoiled Celtir in Southgate?
She thinks she loves him. You killed him. That's all that matters to her now.
Mykella could only shake her head.
Captain Maeltor, lady,
announced Chalmer from outside the study door.
Have him enter.
Maeltor stepped into the study.
I take it that Maximt has fled,
said Mykella.
Yes, lady.
That's not your fault. I should have sent someone as soon as I finished the investiture. What about the healer?
His study is untouched. It's very neat. He's not there. I sent several men to his home, but they have not returned.
Thank you. For now, I'd appreciate it if you'd stand by in the antechamber until Commander Ares returns.
Yes, lady.
Once Maeltor had left the study, Mykella turned and studied the desk, as well as the chair behind it. She'd need a higher chair if she were to use the desk, let alone not to appear dwarfed by it. She shook her head.
What?
Asked Salia.
So many things to do. Big things, little things. You can't do them all at once,
Salia said, her tone reasonable.
No, but if I don't do most of them soon, matters will get worse. What do you want me to do?
At that moment, there was another rap on the door.
Commander Ares, lady,
announced Chalmer. Salia looked to Mykella.
He didn't mention Chelezor.
Have him enter. Ares stepped into the study. While he'd clearly blotted his face, it was still shiny, and his tunic was damp in places. The Lady Chelezor has fled Tempra, Lady Protector. My men are attempting to discover which road she may have taken, or whether she fled by the river. Mykella couldn't say she was totally surprised by her aunt's departure. She did have to admire Chelezar's speed of action.
Commander, if you would come with me.
As she sensed his concern, she added,
We're only going to the lower levels of the palace.
Salia's eyebrows rose.
You'd better come as well, Salia,
added Mykella, absently fingering the pouch at her waist that held the keys to all the locks in the palace, keys she had carried from the day of her mother's death years before. Both Ares and Salia followed her as she walked swiftly from the study to the main staircase, then down and along the west corridor, not quite so far as to the rear door to the gardens, but to a locked door, one that looked like a closet door. It wasn't, but the door to the narrow staircase down to the lowest levels of the palace.
What's down here?
Asked Salia.
You know, but you'll see why.
Mykella eased the proper key on the iron ring into the lock, turned it, and opened the door. Three sets of boots echoed dully down the narrow stairwell to the small foyer at the bottom, where Mykella paused and glanced at the ancient light torch in the bronze wall bracket before heading through the archway that separated the staircase foyer from the subterranean and empty hallway that extended the entire length of the north side of the palace.
Mykella,
ventured Salia.
There's nothing down here that shouldn't be.
Mykella wondered momentarily if she should have used her talent to slip down to the table chamber unseen.
But then, how would you have explained your absence? That's going to be a problem.
Brisk steps brought her to the door set in the middle of the wall closest to the outside foundation, a door of ancient oak with an equally antique lever handle. Yet that lever, old as it had to be, seemed newer than the hinges or than even the replacement stones that comprised the door jamb. She pressed the lever down, and the hinges still squeaked as she opened the door. In spite of herself, she shook her head. She had asked the palace steward 3 times to have the hinges oiled. Was the staff that fearful of the lower level? She turned to Erased.
This is the table chamber.
Then she looked to her sister.
Did father ever bring you here?
Just 2x. It bothered me.
Mykella could tell that Salia was uneasy, although there was nothing overtly that strange about the windowless stone-walled space, some 5 yards by 7, without furnishings except for a single black wooden chest and the table itself, a block of blackish stone set into the floor, whose flat and mirrored surface was level with her waist, her lowest ribs, really, she had to admit. The faint purple tinge that had bothered her for the last several seasons, and that in years so far she was the only one to sense, seemed to have faded since she had destroyed the Ifrit's creation that had emerged from the table and tried to enslave her. It was hard to believe that the Ifrits were essentially the descendants, or perhaps cousins of sorts, of the legendary electors.
If you'd close the door...
Erais did so, not speaking, as Mykella walked over to the table and glanced down. Once she had doubted the old tales about how, before the cataclysm, the electors, and even Mykle the Great, had been able to travel from table to table all across Chorus. Then she had found that she could do so, although some table chambers she had visited were blocked from outside, and one was located somewhere that was so cold that she'd almost frozen to death before managing to return to Tempera. Now, those tables, a few buildings, the eternal and indestructible highways, the great piers and the green towers, were all that remained from that time. Mykella looked at her own reflection in the mirror surface of the table. Short black hair, broad forehead with clear skin, green eyes with a darkness behind them, a straight nose, shoulders too broad for a woman as small as she was.
Might I ask why we are here?
Erased finally asked.
To see if I can determine if the table will show where Chelezor might be at this moment. I don't know if you can see what it displays, but we might as well try.
She did not look up, as Erased stepped up to her left and Salia to her right. Mykella concentrated, fixing an image of Chelezor in her mind and projecting it toward the table. Her own reflection faded, and the silvery black gave way to swirling silvery white mists. Then, an image appeared in the center of the mists, that of a wide barge with 10 men or so at the sweeps. Mykella concentrated on the barge, and the image in the table enlarged enough that she could make out the dark hair and fine features of Chelezor looking out from a hooded winter jacket toward the rear of the barge. Then she tried to get a better sense of where the barge was.
It's all fuzzy,
murmured Salia. She's on the river, said Air-Aced.
"Do you know where?"
asked Mykella.
"I don't recognize what's along the bank. The north bank, isn't it, from the light?"
"I can't be sure, but it looks like the stretch on the Vaedral west of Tempra. No more than 10 vaunts from the Great Piers."
"That's not far," said Salia.
"It might as well be 100 vaunts, replied Air-Aced. "There's no bridge across the river until Hieron, and that's more than 400 vaunts. The road on our side of the river isn't much more than a dirt track after the first 30 vaunts, and there's no road at all on the squat side."
"She's going to get away? Just like that?"
asked Salia.
"Do you have a better idea?"
asked Mykella evenly.
"No, but it seems so wrong." "Sometimes that happens. Unhappily, I doubt we've seen the last of dear Aunt Chelezor."
Mykella looked to Air-Aced.
"I had Chalmer draft the documents to promote you and Major Choalt. We might as well go back to the study so that I can sign them and see what else has gone wrong."
She turned and headed toward the door from the table chamber. 2. Late that evening, after a modest supper by themselves in the family dining area, Salia and Mykella sat in the family parlor, Salia on the settee, and Mykella in the armchair across from her. Rachelana remained closeted in her room, refusing to leave it except for necessities, and only when Mykella was nowhere close. Outside, in the chill darkness, a light drizzle fell, and tiny raindrops coagulated and ran down the window panes in narrow rivulets. Only one wall lamp was lit, and Mykella noted, absently, that the mantle was soot-smoked.
"I can't believe Chelezor left so quickly," observed Salia. "She must have fled the palace right after the ceremony and packed her things immediately. She couldn't have taken that much. She hardly had any time at all."
"She thinks she'll reclaim whatever she left later. She's taking the river to Hieron. From there, she'll make her way to Harmony, and she'll try to get her older brother and any allies he has to attack Lanacrona and overthrow me, in order to make her child the heir and eventual Lord Protector," said Mykella, recalling what her uncle's widow had told her about her background when Mykella had been forced to apologize to Chelezar over the dress incident.
"Her child? I didn't know she was expecting."
"She's carrying Joramil's child. That was the reason she tried to poison Rachel on her at that afternoon gathering."
"How did you know it was poison? You've never said."
"I just knew."
Salia looked at her older sister.
"Knew or knew?"
"Sometimes I can sense poison. It makes people look bluish. It was the same poison Uncle Joramil used to kill Father."
Salia paled. She swallowed.
"Mykella, you're scaring me. Again."
"You didn't think I'd have done everything I've done if I didn't know what was happening. I told Father about Joramil. He wouldn't believe me."
That wasn't totally true, Mykella knew. She'd told their father that Kiedrin hadn't been the one stealing golds from the treasury, and she'd tried to point out that Joramil had been the only one who could have, but her father had been adamant that he could totally trust his brother. After a long silence, Salia said tentatively,
"But Rachelona didn't die."
She paused.
"You were alone with her. You did something, didn't you? To save her?"
"Yes, but she didn't drink as much of it, and I was there when it struck. I tried to save Father the same way, but he'd had too much, and it was too late. Joramil saw that no one got to Father until he was almost dead.
The last of Mykella's words dripped venom.
I should tell Rachelona about how you saved her.
She won't believe you, and she'll want to know why I couldn't save father. Then she'll be blaming me for that.
Mykella, how did it all happen? What changed you?
Mykella thought. How much did she really want to say? Finally, she said,
It's happened because of the Sora. She came to my room just before season turn, and she touched my forehead and told me I had to find my talent if I wanted to save my land.
Salia shivered.
The ancient said that?
She didn't speak. It's more like her words came into your thoughts. Things... they didn't happen all at once. I discovered I could see in almost total darkness, and I began to sense what people felt. That was when I discovered that Joromil was stealing gold. But I found that out by talking to traders and seltiers and comparing tariff receipts to the ledgers. When I showed the ledgers to Father, he just told Joromil, and Joromil forced poor Kiedrin to write a suicide note and drink poison. I even saw Joromil in the table, riding somewhere with a man covered with a hood. Afterwards, I realized that it must have been Kiedrin. It was like that for weeks. All fall long, in fact. Everything I tried turned out wrong.
Mykella shook her head.
But you looked so powerful and strong today.
I made too many mistakes along the way, and people died. Kiedrin, Jeriksilt, Father, the clerk who handled the Southern Guard accounts, the poor guard who was blamed for Jeriksilt's death. Maybe others I don't even know about.
Do you kill?
No. I learned that from practicing on killing animals in the slaughterhouse just before they were about to be killed. No one saw me, and some of them dropped dead just before the hammer hit them. But I didn't figure out how to do that until after Father died.
Salia's eyes were wide.
You still scare me, Mykella.
Why? Joromil killed more people than I have, and he used poison and treachery. So I can kill people with talent. You've trained with arms, and you can kill them with a blade. I'd end up cutting myself to pieces if I tried that.
It's different.
Mykella took a deep breath. Nothing she said was likely to change her sister's mind. Not at the moment, anyway. Maybe once Salia thought it over.
Why did you designate Erased as your heir?
Salia finally asked. Mykella offered a rueful smile.
Why do you think?
You wanted the support of the Southern Guards.
That... and I didn't want to upset things any more than I had to.
Mykella paused.
Right now, as things are, would you want to be designated as my heir?
Salia tilted her head.
No. At first I was hurt. Then I realized that your decision protects both Rachelona and me. A little, anyway. We can't do what you can.
Mykella wanted to say that she couldn't do what Salia could with weapons, but realized that saying it would come out as condescending.
That's only for now.
Can you teach me what you know?
I don't know. Did you really see anything in the table?
No. I didn't want to say anything.
Salia paused.
Ares did, didn't he? Is he like you?
No. He has to have a trace of talent, but that doesn't mean he could do what I can. The old record said that some of the followers of Mykel could see the Sora who appeared to him during the cataclysm, but most could not, and none of the others who saw the ancient ever showed talent.
Again, that wasn't quite true. There was no record of any of them showing talent, but if someone had wanted to conceal it, who would know after hundreds of years?
The Sora appeared to me in the walled garden the first time. That was several days before she touched me, and I could see her, but Rachelona was standing next to me, looking right at the Sora, and she saw nothing.
Mykella could sense Salia's disappointment, and added,
I didn't see her ever before that. Maybe you will.
You're just trying to cheer me up.
Mykella smiled gently.
Is there anything wrong with that?
I'm glad you tried.
Salia stood.
I'm tired. It's been a long day.
It has.
That was something on which they could definitely agree. Mykella was tired. She'd spent the afternoon discussing the necessary changes in guarding the palace and other matters involving the southern guards with Aeraist, following his recommendations, except about supplies, where she had asked him to look into several matters before dealing with procurement. Salia had been closeted with the Chatelaine, trying to take over what Mykella had done for years. Mykella rose and followed Salia from the family parlor, then to her own bedchamber, the one that had been hers from the time she could remember, and the one she needed to leave if she wanted any privacy at all, since its door opened onto the main upper corridor. That had never been a problem when she'd been the relatively insignificant daughter of the Lord Protector, but now, with Southern guards posted practically outside her door, unfortunately with reason, it would be. She'd already asked Chalmer and Chatelaine Aurelia to remove any personal items of her father's or Joramil's from the apartments that had served them, and to clean the rooms thoroughly before she moved into the small suite that held a personal study, a sitting room, a wash chamber, and a bedchamber. As she bolted the door to her bedchamber, she hoped she could sleep. 3. Septy morning, Mykella was up and in the family breakfast room, early. She hadn't slept well. Salia was already there, looking down at a mug of something, likely cider, and she had circles under her eyes. The two ate, almost silently. Not surprisingly, Rachelana had not yet made an appearance at breakfast, and before getting up to finish readying herself for the day, Mykella instructed Murgia that on no account was Rachelana to be served in her room, and that no special meals were to be prepared for her.
You can leave something here for her, but nothing more, Mykella concluded.
Yes, lady.
The serving girl glanced toward Salia, then back to Mykella.
Just tell her that those were my instructions.
Yes, lady.
Murgia repeated before hurrying away into the serving pantry.
That will just make her more angry,
Salia observed.
I'm sorry if it does, but she'd rather have had us married off and enslaved and Lana Krona in ruins.
It will be anyway. Your romantic dreams won't last long.
The bitter words came from Rachelana, who stood in the doorway, attired in a long black dress with a black shawl and a set of polished black onyx beads around her neck. Her eyes were slightly bloodshot, and her mahogany red hair was swept back into two silver clips.
You won't be able to kill every armsman that the other lands send against you.
You're assuming that all of them will attack,
said Mykella, taking a last swallow of tea from her mug.
You're assuming that they won't. Besides, just how many of the Southern Guards will follow your tame commander?
All of them, just about,
replied Salia.
He's anything but tame. He's the first commander in years with field experience, and they respect him.
Oh, I forgot. You spar with the Guards. You think they'd tell you the truth?
They have so far, replied Salia.
For a moment, Rachelana said nothing. Then she walked to the far end of the table and seated herself. Mykella looked at Rachelana, wondering whether she should say more. Salia shook her head. Mykella cleared her throat.
When you're up to it, Rachel Honor, we do need to talk.
Why? You'll do whatever you want. You always have. Salia winced.
Because,
replied Mykella calmly as she rose from the table,
I'll only be guessing what you'd like unless I know what it is you want. Even so, after we do talk, you'll still say that you told me what you wanted and that I ignored you, even when I haven't. You know where to find me.
Rachelana looked away. After glancing at Salia, who gave the smallest of headshakes, Mykella left the breakfast room. Back in her bedchamber, possibly for the last time, Mykella glanced into the mirror over the dressing table. She'd decided that she'd continue wearing what she always wore, the black night silk camisole and under trousers, with a black night silk shirt that was really a tunic, and black night silk trousers over her black boots. The double layer of night silk was warm enough, if sometimes in summer too warm, and offered protection against all manner of weapons, even without her talent shields. As form-fitting as the night silk undergarments were, their protection was not absolute. The fabric, woven from the wool of the night sheep of the Iron Valleys, stiffened harder than iron under a blade thrust or a bullet, but the pressure still caused some injury, especially given Mykella's tendency to bruise easily. Holding talent shields for a long time, she'd discovered the previous day, was also exhausting, although she knew she'd need to do so whenever she left the palace. Hopefully, she could work out a compromise that protected her without wearing her down. She turned away from the mirror and stepped from the chamber, walking toward the southwest corner of the palace that held the formal study library. There were still two guards stationed in the main corridor flanking the outer study doors, and she nodded to both as she stepped past them into the antechamber. Chalmer stood waiting inside.
Good morning, Lady Protector. A Major Smalltalk is waiting below. He requests that he be allowed to see you. He is...
the aide to Envoy Shiorok. At the moment, I'd prefer to see the Major rather than the Envoy.
Mykella had no doubts Smalltalk knew that as well, which was why he was requesting the audience. Chalmer nodded.
There is also a written request from Envoy Mollerick.
I'll see him tomorrow afternoon. Late in the afternoon.
Mykella didn't feel like seeing the Celtier from Southgate at all, but there was no sense in putting off such a meeting more than that, and there wasn't anyone else she trusted to handle the matter. Not yet.
Oh, would you arrange meetings for me with Minister Garrick, Minister Porifer, and Forrester Loriault? I'd like to start with Lord Garrick, if possible, but I'd like to see Commander Aerace after I meet with the Defoyon if the Commander's around.
Chalmer offered a slight smile.
I am certain I can do that. Will you see the Defoyon Major immediately?
There's no reason not to, is there?
I would think not. I will send for him.
Thank you, Chalmer.
The older scrivener inclined his head before leaving, and Mykella stepped into the formal study. The account ledgers she had requested were stacked on a side table, and she took the main ledger, the one that summarized the expenses by ministry. She smiled. Chalmer had provided a thick, square pillow for the seat of the desk chair. She'd barely studied the first half page of the ledger when there was a rap on the door, and Smalltalk, wearing the uniform of a Defoyon Lancer, stepped into the study and bowed deeply.
Lady Protector.
Mykella closed the ledger, eased it aside, rose from behind the desk, and gestured to one of the chairs before the desk.
Please sit down.
When she had danced with Smalltalk at the ball some 10 days before, He had appeared to be some 10 years older than she was, but seeing him in the study, she decided he was likely closer to 15, with a few silver hairs amid the light brown short-cut thatch. She reseated herself and waited until he looked at her, appraisingly.
"What can I do for you, Major?"
"You understand, Lady Protector, that Envoy Shirak finds himself in an anomalous position."
Again, Mykella noted his heavy accent, but it scarcely bothered her, and that had to be the effect of her talent in some way.
"So he sent you to determine what that might be?"
From the feelings she sensed, small talk was acting on his own, but she wanted to get his response.
"No, lady. You already know I have taken that liberty because, with your accession to power, everything will change drastically all across Chorus. While I am but a simple major and an aid to the heir of light, I am from Deferia. I have seen the power of the ancients. You hold that power. I would not have it arrayed against the Land Archer, his heir, and I would prefer a certain understanding between Lana Kroner and Deferia."
Much as she liked Smalltalk's frank and warm directness, Mykella smiled coolly.
"You want an understanding rather than a treaty, because any formal alliance might cause others to act contrary to Defoyor's interests, not to mention the fact that if you or Envoy Shirok proposed it, the Land Arch would be offended, if not forced to repudiate it or discipline you both. Yet you also do not want Lana Kroner to consider the Land Arch as an enemy or as opposed to our interests."
Smalltalk's smile was half embarrassed, half rueful.
"Let me also say that the Heir of Light would have been greatly overmatched had you not changed circumstances."
"In response to the question you did not ask, Major, my sisters will be allowed to make their own choices in the matter of marriages, and I strongly doubt that either will agree to a match without meeting a prospective suitor. Nor will I agree to such unless I meet that suitor."
Smalltalk nodded slowly.
"That will make matters difficult."
"You should also know that I have been more impressed by the manner in which you and Envoy Shirok have comported yourselves than I have been with any other envoys."
Smalltalk nodded.
"Thank you. Perhaps we should return to Derica to consult with the Landarch."
Mykella nodded.
"You will need to inform both the Landarch and Aldekar of the changes in circumstances, but before you depart, I would suggest that you wait for a missive from me to the Landarch. It might be a day or so."
"I do believe we can wait for a day or so."
Smalltalk smiled.
"Or even the 10 long days of a week."
Mykella could sense the last unspoken words as if they had been written on the air between them, and that the idea of waiting actually pleased the officer. She'd have to think about that. She was learning that while she might sense what people felt, knowing how they felt often didn't translate into knowing why they felt that way. She rose.
"Good day, Major. I appreciate your initiative, and I trust you will convey my best to Envoy Shirok."
The Major stood quickly and bowed.
"That I will, lady."
Mykella walked to the window and looked out on a morning that remained grey, though the clouds had lifted somewhat. The drizzle had stopped, but the stones of the courtyard still held the sheen of rain. She wasn't totally looking forward to seeing those of minister rank who had served her father, although there were not that many. Government in Lana Krona was comparatively simple. The finance ministry set and collected tariffs, served as depository and as a reserve holder for the commercial lending houses, and minted all Lana Kronan coinage. The Ministry of Highways and Rivers maintained the ports and piers, including the towpaths and maintenance buildings on the Vedra and the major irrigation canals of Lanacrona. It also set the standards for all canals and sewers, and inspected the sewers and the mid-size irrigation works across Lanacrona. The Ministry of Justice, headed by Lord Garrick, supervised and set the standards for all local patrols throughout Lanacrona, operated all the low courts, and the Court of Review in Tempra, maintained the jails, the workhouses and work camps for lawbreakers, and administered the official standards of weights and measures. The arms commander of Lanacrona was the head of the Southern Guards and responsible for all its men and facilities. If Lanacrona were invaded, and the Lord Protector, or Lady Protector, issued a proclamation, the arms commander could also conscript able-bodied men to serve for the duration of the invasion. Lastly, there was the forester of Lanacrona, responsible for all permits for logging on the Protector's lands and on all privately held lands, and for inspecting and assuring that all logged lands were replanted. 5 branches of government under the Lady Protector, and one of them was vacant.
So far.
The study door opened a fraction.
The commander is here, lady.
Have him come in.
Mykella turned and walked back to the desk, waiting for Erased. The commander entered, wearing the cream and blue uniform of the Southern Guards and carrying a roll of paper, possibly a map. She surveyed him, both with her eyes and her talent, almost smiling as she found his eyes appraising her. He was interested. That she could sense. He was also cautious. That was also good. She was in no hurry to match herself. Besides, not marrying immediately might hold off her enemies a little, particularly if they happened to think she might be available.
Let them think that for now.
Lady, you summoned me.
She gestured for him to take a chair and seated herself.
Before we discuss other matters, Erased began, I wanted you to know that I have assigned Captain Mailtor to duty here in the palace for the time being. He has a trusted squad at his command, and he answers only to you or me in your absence.
Mykella nodded.
You foresee difficulties?
No one can force you to do anything, but it might be more acceptable if you use the captain to deal with some situations, rather than your rather formidable abilities. Mykella laughed gently.
You're saying politely that I might otherwise be in a situation where I might have to slaughter some angry man, and that having him escorted away by the captain would be politically more acceptable.
Do you not think so? Erased smiled.
In this I accept your counsel and assistance, Commander.
For today he will be stationed in your antechamber, with a guard for a courier. After a moment, Erased went on.
There is one other matter with which I must trouble you. Only one?
Asked Mykella gently.
Or merely the most pressing?
The most awkward, I fear. You had ordered that the bodies of the usurper and his son be tended to his family, for cremation and placement in the family memorial.
Oh.
Mykella swallowed. With Chelazar's flight from Tempra, Mykella was effectively the most senior member of Joromil's family. Amid everything else, that aspect of matters hadn't struck.
Have Chalmer and the steward arrange for the cremation this evening. Their ashes will go in the family mausoleum. Traitors or not, they were family. There will be no ceremony.
Erased nodded.
You did summon me. In what else might I be of aid? You saw in the table that Chelazar is headed back to North Coast, did you not?
A quick flash of puzzlement flickered in his pale green eyes as he sat, the map still held in his left hand. I saw her in a barge on the Vedra, as did you. The Vedra flows west and north from Tempra. That is in the general direction of North Coast.
You wonder why I asked that? Because not everyone can see what appears in the table.
Mykella paused.
I did not tell you that Chelezor is carrying Joromil's child.
I had wondered with the haste of her departure. Erased's lips, neither thin nor excessively full, quirked into a faintly rueful smile. The envoy from Prince Skrellen is still here in Tempra, you know.
I knew he was here. I assumed he hadn't left yet.
You know why he is here?
Joromil said he was seeking a match for his son, presumably with Rachel on her. I haven't found any missives or papers.
Mykella snorted, a most unladylike sound, but she didn't care.
I won't either.
It is unlikely. I have found none in the studies of either Commander Nefrit or Commander Demel. When there are no records, that suggests matters are not as they should be. Erased cleared his throat. Prince Skrellen is seeking a match, but not for his son. His consort died 2 seasons ago in childbirth. He has no sons. Mykella could read the political currents.
Chelezor's older brother is Prince of North Coast. He and Skrellen were already considering attacking Lanacrona, according to Joromil.
Doubtless they were, or would have, if your father had remained Lord Protector. By all accounts, Prince Chalcare is most ambitious.
If Skrellen married Chelezor, how very convenient.
Mykella's voice dripped venom.
If Chelezor offers herself as the tool for taking Lanacrona, she might end up the way she'd planned to deal with Baronet, and then she might not.
Mykella had no doubts of just how ambitious and capable her aunt was. Precisely. That might be even more to his liking than a match with one of your sisters.
Any suitor for my sisters will have to meet them. In person. They deserve that.
Erased nodded.
Your thoughts on the Lady Chelezor, Commander?
She will exaggerate our weaknesses for her own interests, Erased replied. Many of those weaknesses are real enough without overstatement, and both princes are aware of them.
Those weaknesses are?
I had thought we should discuss such matters. I brought a map.
Go ahead.
Mykella pointed to the clear surface of the desk and stood. Short as she was, that was the easiest way for her to see. Erased stood, unrolling the map. We have 2 few companies, and some are not close to full strength, such as the 2 in Supat, and the 4th and 7th companies in Heolt. 6th company is at full strength, but Captain Suoral is ailing. He's 10 years past the age for a stipend. The other 3 companies in Dekron are also at strength.
That's where Maeltor was being sent?
Erased nodded. We can't count on the garrison at Indior either, loyal as the companies there are.
Because of the distance from Crossed, or because the companies are armed and trained to deal with nomads and brigands?
All of that. Also, the removal of any of the companies would invite immediate attacks from the raiders and brigands in the Lower Spine Mountains. Erased spread out the map, securing the corners with flat lead weights he extracted from a belt pouch. This shows the northernmost regions of Lanacrona, those south of the Vedra, and west from about 200 vaunts east of Tempra. He pointed. Here is the road west to Hafin.
That's the only way Skrellen can enter Lanacrona without taking lanes or marching through woods and fields, is it not?
At least until he nears our borders.
Chalcare would have to take the Highway of the Electors south from Harmony to Salsair. Is that not close to 900 vaunts?
Asked Mykella. It is more than 800.
Then he would still have several hundred vaunts from Salsa to our border, observed Mykella, unless he wanted to fight his way through the Iron Valleys, or straggle along the north side of the Vaedror and amass enough barges and boats to cross. That would be far longer and more difficult. Doesn't that make it more likely that Chalcare would propose that Midcoast and North Coast act in concert?
Erased laughed, harshly, if softly. Greed and ambition can forge an alliance of convenience, but mistrust will quickly dissolve it.
But if Chalcare offers his sister, more likely she'll offer herself.
That might be inducement enough, admitted Erased.
Especially if they think we are weak.
Mykella's eyes traversed the map.
How many Southern Guard companies could we transfer from south and the east? Could we base them in Vianset for a time?
We could pull two companies from Supat immediately, and all of them for a time. We can wait a week to decide about how many companies to move from Dekron. From farther to the east? There are three companies along the high road to Darica. Removing them will weaken our eastern borders, lady.
We should consider shifting one or two companies. At the moment we have less to fear from the Landarch than from Prince Skrellen.
Best we do so now. It will take a 10-day for a courier to reach 11th Company.
That's the one in the waystation fort on the high road due south of Emal.
Yes.
You'd leave 13th Company at the eastern borderland station?
I would.
What about conscription?
Erased's almost hidden wince told Mykella more than the words that followed. It would take companies to train the conscripts. And time. In the end, Mykella and Erased agreed on immediately shifting seven companies to join the two stationed in Tempra, and to basing all of them temporarily in Vianset. Erased left to issue the orders, since it would take nearly a week for the orders to reach Hialt, and more than that, Supat. The only saving grace was that it would likely take at least 2 weeks for Chelazar to reach Harmony. If need be, three companies stationed in Dekron, and one in Borlan, could be barged down the Vaedra to Tempra, but the more distant companies needed to be notified as soon as possible.
What if you're wrong?
For a land the size of Lanacrona, the number of Southern Guard companies was far too few. 23 companies. The guards should number at least twice that many. Erased hadn't exactly said that, but it had been clear enough.
Yet, from where would the golds have come to pay for supporting such a force?
Mykella shook her head, her eyes flicking to the ledgers on the table set in front of the built-in bookcases that dated to the construction of the palace. She needed to go over the tariffs paid by the Celtiers and merchants, as well as the expenses. Especially the expenses. She retrieved the master ledger and began to study the fall summaries. In less than a quarter glass, she was frowning, noting that the Ministry of Rivers and Highways was spending almost as much as the Southern Guards was. That was something she'd noted in passing earlier, but upon reflection, it seemed far too high. The indestructible Eternastone of the Electors comprised the main highways, as did the piers at Dekron and Tempra. The river required little maintenance, except for the towpath on the south side. But there were 10 waterway inspectors. She frowned again. She was missing something.
Cholma?
The old scrivener opened the door.
Yes, lady?
Do you know all the kinds of inspections that Lord Porifer's inspectors conduct?
Chalmer frowned.
They inspect the piers and the towpaths, the large irrigation channels. Oh, the sewers in the major towns and cities.
Is there a list of their duties?
Why, yes. It's been a while, but if you wouldn't mind...
The older man scanned the shelves to the left of the desk.
Here. These are the compilations of duties. They haven't changed much since Mykle the Great wrote them out. Well, some say that the hand was Rachelor's.
Thank you. Why didn't you notice? Or even look?
Once Chalmer had left the study, Mykella rose and pulled out volume after volume, quickly scanning them. While the books had been dusted, none had been opened in years, and over half were written in an older script that she had to struggle to make out.
Is that similar to what the Ifrit had spoken?
How would she know? She'd never seen it written. A glass later, she sat back down at the desk, stunned. The most recent volume dated from the time of Riston, Mickle's son, and, from what she had skimmed quickly, it appeared to lay out the duties of the ministers of Lanacrona and even the limits of the powers of the Protector. There was no mention of a Lord Protector. Except for one book, she hadn't seen anything on military tactics, but there was a folio of maps that looked to be superior in quality to the map Erased had used. She wasn't surprised that she hadn't known the contents of all the volumes. Her father had largely kept her out of the study. He'd certainly never thought she'd become his successor. But Jerixilt had never mentioned the books either, and most of them didn't seem to have been opened in years, except for those on the shelf at desk level directly behind the desk, consisting of a thin book of maxims, poems, and proverbs, apparently written by the first Farinit. The single book on tactics, with a preface that noted it had been copied from an older version predating the Cataclysm, two books on construction and engineering, one apparently on the justicing system of the electors, and two histories. Mykella was still trying to make sense out of what was on the study shelves when Chalmer rapped on the door.
Lord Garrick, lady.
Good.
Mykella stood and waited for the slender, short, and balding Minister of Justice to enter. Garrick bowed, then smiled warmly at her.
Lady Protector.
I might not be, except for you and your wife, Lord Garrick.
Mykella gestured for him to seat himself, and did so herself.
And the portrait of Rachelor.
She recalled how amazed she had been to see how closely she resembled the wife of Mykle the Great.
You do look like her, even more so now.
Garrick seated himself, his eyes intent on her.
How might I be of service, lady?
First, by continuing as Minister of Justice.
I would be pleased to do so.
Garrick added,
I will begin immediately on the legalities of properties.
Legalities of properties?
The Minister of Justice serves as the advocate for the Lord Protector, or the Lady Protector, and all the properties of the Protector, as well as any other interests, must be listed with the ascension of each Protector and published within a season. That includes all properties of a spouse. Annually, any new properties obtained or divested must also be listed each year by the turn of spring. This has been so since the later years of Mykle the Great. Of course, since you are the heir of both your father and your uncle, matters may be more complicated. Or they may not be.
Garrick smiled.
I did not know that. Then there are many things I may not know, and I would hope you will continue to enlighten me.
I will do my best, lady. I would beg your indulgence to suggest a few reforms.
Mykella could sense only concern and some worry.
Along what lines, Lord Garrick?
As Minister of Justice, I do not receive reports, timely or otherwise, about the decisions made by city and regional justices and the sentences meted out. Nor do I receive reports on the numbers of offences and offenders, and I do not have enough men trained in law to spend the days or weeks watching and reporting on what is happening in each hamlet, town, and city. Without such reports, it is difficult to determine whether justice in Supat is even roughly equivalent to justice in Tempra or in Heolt, or...
Garrick shrugged.
The older records indicate that such reports were once required.
Mykella nodded.
Perhaps you should draft a document that outlines what information is necessary and how it should be presented. Then you could explain them to me.
She smiled. If I approve of something, I will certainly have to explain it to someone. Or many people.
With your permission, I will draft just that.
I would also like to see if you have any other observations that might be useful to me, or about various ministry positions.
The only vacant ministry is that of finance, and you, lady, know more about the accounts than does anyone I could recommend.
That may be, and I will keep close watch on them, but a lady protector,
she almost said Lord Protector,
who tries to do everything will do none of it well.
I do not do well at responding immediately to such, lady. I would request that you allow me some time to consider.
I would be more than happy to have you consider those who might be able and honest in the service of Lanacrona.
She paused.
You and Lady Garrick, in fact.
Jailara is a good judge of character, and you must have noticed that I do rely upon her.
I would like to rely upon you both.
With scarcely a pause, Mykella asked,
What do you think about Forrester Loriolt?
Garrick tilted his head slightly before responding.
He is a good man. He knows the forests well. He is honest. He may be too trusting in his dealings with the large landholders, particularly in the east.
You think that too many logging permits are being granted?
That I could not say. I do not know about forests except that they grow slowly, especially in the eastern hills and highlands. The Celtiers of Southgate pay well for prime timber, especially for hardwoods, even though it takes almost a season to send a wagon to Southgate.
How can they afford that?
Asked Mykella.
They have no choice. The hardwood forests of Midcoast have been largely overcut, and it is even farther from the dark woods of Northcoast to Southgate. Also, the Prince of Midcoast imposes a passage tariff on all trade that does not begin or end in his lands.
Something else you didn't know.
Mykella nodded.
What can you tell me about Lord Porifer?
Again, Garrick hesitated before replying.
Lord Porifer is well respected. He is known to be astute in his dealings in fabrics and in carpets, and he is said to have many connections with all manner of factors and Celtiers in Southgate. I believe that Envoy Mollerick has been enjoying the hospitality of Porifer's Tempera Villa. Other Celtiers have as well.
What of his time as minister?
Lord Porifer has always been interested in maintaining what is conducive to profitable trade at the lowest cost to traders. The towpaths are well maintained, as are the way stations to the west and south. What else can I say, lady?
Mykella understood perfectly.
Tell me more about yourself, Lord Garrick.
Were my vanity greater than it is, I would say I am a simple man, gifted by birth and land so that I could study the law. But no man is simple, much as he would like to believe that. My forebears were herders with the foresight to acquire land when it could be acquired easily, and they did. More recent ancestors managed it well, and I have had the fortune to be able to pay others to do the same, so that I may live in modest comfort in tempera. Our daughters are well and happily wed.
Mykella listened to Garrick's comparatively short autobiography, then asked a few questions before allowing him to depart. She stood, stretched, and walked once more to the window, looking through the glass without really seeing anything. Garrick's responses to her questions disturbed her, not because there had been any deception behind his words, but because there had been none at all. After taking a deep breath, she returned to the bookshelves beside the desk and searched through the volumes Chalmer had pointed out, until she found a thin, ancient tome that described the government structure of Tempera, or at least as it had been in the time of Mikkel's son, Riston, also sometimes referred to as Olent, although the histories never said why. She began to read. Less than 10 pages later, Chalmer rapped on the study door.
Lord Porifer is here.
Have him come in.
Mykella set the ancient manual aside and stood. The hawk-nosed and black-haired Celtier brushed past Chalmer and into the study. He did not incline his head.
Lord Porifer, began Mykella.
Before she could even gesture for the Celtier to sit, Porifer spoke. I would like to tender my resignation as Minister of Highways and Rivers.
Might I ask why, Lord Porifer?
Mykella remained standing. I do not feel that I can continue in the position to your satisfaction. Porifer's voice was clipped, almost brusque. Mykella could sense irritation as well as anger and fear, but she continued to keep her voice even and pleasant.
My satisfaction, Lord Porifer. I don't believe we've even discussed your ministry. Or has some action of which I am unaware led you to this conclusion?
Porifer looked at her coolly, although anger surged within him.
The manner in which you terminated one of my peers was rather abrupt.
Arms Commander Nefrit? I killed him only after he slashed me with a saber. Considering that he killed my brother as well, I think two such treasonous acts more than justified my action. You might note that I merely banished Commander Demel, although he was involved to some degree in my brother's death. Or did you feel that I was too lenient with Commander Demel?
I wish you well, but I cannot in good conscience remain as a ministry lord.
I do understand, Lord Porifer.
Mykella let her voice become almost sickeningly sweet.
I would not wish any man to act against his conscience, especially in serving a lady protector. I do wish you well.
She turned and projected her voice.
Chalmer, send in the captain.
Porifer stiffened.
I'm just giving you the honor you deserve, Porifer,
Mykella said in the same sweet tone she'd just used. Maeltor stepped through the study door.
Yes, Lady Protector?
Lord Porifer has tendered his resignation as Lord Minister for Highways and Rivers. Since he has served loyally, I would like him escorted from the palace with honor. Have his personal study sealed until I can inspect it later today.
Mykella turned to Porifer and smiled.
Any personal items you may have left in the study will be sent wherever in Tempera you wish.
You're being high-handed,
Porifer said coldly.
Less than you, Porifer. I've heard not one word of respect, and you've seethed the entire time you've been here with anger and resentment at having to face a lady protector. Since two others who served my father committed treason, I don't think sealing your study until I can examine it is anything more than a simple precaution.
She smiled. You did not wish to serve me and Lanacrona loyally, and I have accepted your resignation and released you from that obligation, as you wished. I trust you will serve Lanacrona well and loyally in your personal business. She nodded to Maeltor. Escort him from the palace with the respect to which his past services entitle him. He is not to return to the minister's study, not until his successor is appointed, but otherwise he will have the same access to the first level of the palace as any other Celtir does.
Sir, prompted Maeltor.
Mykella could sense the cold fury behind the stony face of the Celtir before he turned and left the study with the captain. Given how strongly Porifer felt, she doubted that she could have said anything, except perhaps begging him, that would have mollified him.
Even that probably wouldn't have worked.
Several moments after the two had left, Chalmer opened the door slightly.
Lady?
You can come in.
Chalmer only eased the door open a trace wider.
I thought you would like to know that Forrester Loriault is somewhere east of Crossed in the Vian Hills. His chief assistant, Kerlik, doesn't expect him back for at least another 4 10 days.
I'd like to have Kerlik tell me about how things are going in the Forestry Ministry. The first glass of the afternoon tomorrow, before I meet with Envoy Mollerick. If that will be a problem, let me know.
It shouldn't be, but I will, lady.
There was a pause.
Steward Elwaite is arranging for the pyre for this evening.
Thank you. I do appreciate it.
Mykella walked back to the window and looked out. The day was still grey, and that, unfortunately, matched all too well how matters had gone. 4. After mulling over her meeting with Porifer, Mykella occupied herself with studying the account ledgers and plodding through what appeared to be a manual on the law and structure of government, as well as refreshing her geography of Lanacrona and spending more than a glass with Salia, going over the details of running a palace. Late on that septy afternoon, Maeltor and two southern guards accompanied her down to the main level of the palace, to the chambers occupied by the Ministry of Rivers and Highways. Mykella was most careful in going through Porifer's study. She found nothing out of the ordinary, not that she had expected to do so, but she did find a missive from a Celtir Amaric suggesting that since Tempra was the principal beneficiary of trade on that route, Lanacrona should cut back brush along the ancient Eternastone Highway from Tempra to Zolt, where it passed through the southern coast range. She tucked it inside her night silk tunic before instructing the clerks to send Porifer's personal effects to him. Was that Amaric a descendant of the one with whom Mykel had had such difficulties? Does it matter now? After that, with some trepidation, she headed back to the upper level of the palace to see if Aurelia and Salia had completed moving her things and furnishings into the bedchamber that her father had occupied. Salia met her as if she had been waiting.
I wondered where you were.
Seeing if Celtir Porifer had left anything I should know. He resigned this morning. He said he couldn't serve me in the way I wished. What he really meant was that he'd almost rather die than serve a woman.
He won't be the only one,
predicted Salia.
I know, but Garrick will stay, and I can probably handle the finance ministry for a while. I don't know about Loriault.
She shook her head.
Did you move out all of Father's personal things?
Most of them were already gone.
Where are they?
Joromil had them packed up and put in one of the storerooms. I took a quick look. I don't think anything's missing, except for the Lord Protector's ring.
Erased gave that to me yesterday. You were there.
Salia flushed.
Oh, I was. I was. I thought... I don't know what I thought. You were so calm, both of you. I just thought it was a personal ring of father's that Joramil had taken. He was petty that way.
Even Salia had seen it.
Why didn't father?
Mykella wondered if she'd ever know the answer to that question.
Just like you asked,
Salia went on,
I had them move father's bed to your old room, and your things to the apartment bedchamber. I did leave some bookcases. You had so many books stacked in the corner.
The bookcases are fine. Mykella turned toward the rooms that would be hers. There were actually two doors into the apartments, the main one leading into a hallway, off which were the study on the right and the bedchamber on the left. In turn, both the private sitting room and the bath chamber were entered from the bedchamber. The second entrance to the main corridor was from the sitting room directly, but that door had almost always been bolted from inside. The arrangement of rooms was something Mykella would never have praised, but clearly a later adaptation to whatever the building had been before it became the palace. Salia opened the door to the hallway inside the private apartments. Mykella followed, her eyes roving over the paneled walls, bare except for the two tapestries that had always hung there and that depicted an idealized version of the private gardens, one in spring and one in the deep of winter. Mykella sniffed. What was she smelling?
I had everything scrubbed and all the woodwork cleaned with lemon oil,
Salia said, before stepping into the study.
I left the desk and bookcase, but took out the stuffed red deer heads and brought in another nice armchair. It was Mother's favourite. You always liked it.
Oh, exclaimed Mykella involuntarily, as she saw the pair of portraits hung on the wall above the modest writing desk. On the right was a formal portrait of her father, a copy of the one that hung in the gallery of Lord Protectors on the main floor, and on the left was a portrait of her mother that had vanished years before.
I hoped you'd like having the portraits here.
I do. I wondered what father had done with the one of mother.
He sealed all of her things up in a lower storeroom. I hope you don't mind that I brought some of them back.
Oh, no. Mykella smiled, then turned toward the bedchamber. Her old bed stood there, as did the area carpet from her room and her other furnishings. In addition to her own armoire, there was a second, near-identical one. Mykella turned to Salia.
Mother's?
Salia shook her head.
Aunt Lolina's. It was down in the storeroom, and when I saw it matched yours...
She smiled.
I think they were the set that Grandpapa and Grandmother used. You'll need more than one now that you're Lady Protector.
Mykella had to admit, her sister was doubtless right. From the bedchamber, she glanced into the sitting room, noting that the hearth had been cleaned and a fire laid but not put to flame, despite the late afternoon chill, and a blue and cream lambswool blanket had been folded over the back of the settee, as it once had been when she and Salia had been children. She almost shook her head. The last time she'd been in the sitting room had been with her father after Jerick Silt's murder. She swallowed and looked at Salia.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Wyandraw helped me move your garments. I tried to put your things back the way you had them. You'll have to rearrange them, I'm sure.
Mykella stepped forward and hugged Salia.
I can't tell you.
For several moments, they hung on to each other. Then Mykella stepped back and blotted her eyes.
Dinner should almost be ready,
Salia said.
What is it?
Asked Mykella.
Fowl. I told Aurelia to fix the normal things, except that you'd never want river trout again.
Salia laughed.
Was that wrong?
No, I could barely choke down a mouthful of it.
Neither could I.
Before long, the three sisters sat at the long cherry table in the family dining room. Mykella had decided against sitting at the end, where her father had always seated himself, but took the place she had always had since their mother's death years before. She half-filled her goblet from the carafe, letting her talent range over the white wine, but detected no trace of poison. She passed the wine to Rachelana. Her sister took the crystal carafe without a word. Murgia hurried in with two domestic fowl, each sliced into halves, browned, and still steaming, accompanied by cheese-laced potatoes and apricot walnut beans. To Mykella's surprise, the beans were actually warm, and the potatoes hot.
Murgia, she offered, after a mouthful. You have my thanks, and please convey them to the cooks as well.
The serving girl inclined her head, surprised but pleased, and retreated to the serving pantry. The three young women ate in silence for a time. Mykella hadn't realized how hungry she had been, but then she hadn't eaten since breakfast.
I met with the assistant to the envoy from Defoyor this morning, she finally said. What did he say?
Asked Salia.
He wanted to know whether the envoy should return to Derica, and whether either of my sisters might be available to be matched.
To whom will you match me?
Rachelana's tone was quiet, but Mykella sensed the defiance behind it.
I told him that anyone who wished a match with my sisters would have to meet them, and me, first. Then, you may choose whomever you and I can agree upon.
No one will come to Lanacrona.
They will. One way or another. I just hope it's the way I want it to be. The Major did not seem terribly put off by those conditions. Envoy Mollerick has requested a meeting as well, and I'll see him tomorrow afternoon.
He'll likely walk out on you.
Rachelana's words were tart.
He may not be happy, countered Salia, but he won't dare to walk out on you.
I heard that you had that captain march Seltir Porifer from your study all the way out of the palace, said Rachelana.
He tendered his resignation, and I accepted it. As I told him, he is as welcome in the palace as any other Seltir who may have business here.
None of them will.
Between all the meetings of the day, and Rachelana's attitude and remarks throughout dinner, Mykella was more than willing to retreat to the private apartments. Yet once she closed the corridor door behind her and walked through the darkness that was no longer the barrier to movement it once had been, she was anything but ready to sleep. She stood beside the writing desk in the private study, and questions tumbled through her mind. What had she missed? What had she already done wrong? Was she right to trust Erased? Or were her doubts unreasonable, fueled by her reaction to her father's excessively trusting nature? How could she ever make Rachelana understand? And what was she going to do with her? What sort of public appearances should she be making? With whom should she be meeting? Exactly how should she deal with the Seltirs of Tempra, who still held many of the same attitudes about women as did their peers in Southgate? Some of those questions. Some. She might be able to address by using the table. Thankfully, she no longer had to travel the corridors of the palace to reach the table, not if she intended to go there alone. She walked over to the study window and pressed her hand against the stone next to the casement, reaching with her thoughts, her talent, toward the greenish blackness beneath the palace. For a moment, she could not quite connect with the green before it extended upward and enshrouded her. Surrounded by the green that almost no one else saw, she willed herself into the stone and downward, through it, toward the table and into the stillness of the table chamber. Almost by reflex, she let her eyes and senses traverse the table for any sign of an Ifrit's presence. But there was none, save the lingering hint of purpled pinkness, and she stepped over to the table and looked down into its mirrored surface. She concentrated on Erased, worrying about what she might see, since her first uses of the table had shown her brother and Baronet in rather personal and compromising positions with various young ladies. The mists appeared, swirled briefly, and showed a silver-tinged and slightly faint image of Erased sitting at a writing desk in a small stone-walled study that looked similar to the one where Mykella had confronted Commander Demel. A single wall lamp cast light across the map spread before Erased. A goblet of wine stood at the edge of the desk, and the commander took a sip, then set the goblet down and picked up a pair of calipers, measuring a distance on the map, before writing on the paper to the side of the map. Another measurement followed, and another. After seeing the concentration in Erased's face, Mykella let the image fade. Whom else should she survey?
Rachelona?
Her red-haired sister sat in an armchair in her chamber, an embroidery hoop in her hands, her cheeks wet. Mykella swallowed, then let that image fade.
Porifa?
The Celtier sat at a long, oval table with three other Celtiers from their garb. Porifer was talking intently, although his gestures were tight and controlled. Mykella recognized none of the three, and that was good, because those at the table did not include Conasil, the first Celtier of Tempra, nor Lonner, the chief high factor. Even so, it was clear that the four were not happy, and Mykella had few doubts that she was at least in part the cause of that unhappiness.
Maximt?
All the table revealed was that the former chief clerk was in a way station on one of the Eternastone highways, his face shadowed as he stood back from a common cook fire.
Tregit?
The healer was eating at a rough trestle table in what looked to be a small cot that could have been anywhere at all.
Chelezo?
Her aunt was still seated in a barge that appeared to be moving through rain and rough water. Mykella couldn't help but hope that Chelezo was miserable indeed, even as she wondered just how much her aunt had had to do with Joramil's efforts to become Lord Protector. She straightened and let the images in the table lapse.
How long would she have to follow them? Until you can do something about them, or know that they can no longer harm you or Lanacrona.
At the moment, none of those fleeing her were likely more than a day away on a fast mount, and she could travel far faster than that by using the table, or rather, the greenish darkness beneath the tables. She'd already explored the other tables she'd been able to sense, and all of them, except the one in Derica, had turned out to be dead ends of one sort or another. But she'd traveled immense distances in a very short time, and she had been able to follow the blackish-green lines where they lay beneath Tempra. Could she travel along them farther? How much farther? Far enough to be of use to her as Lady Protector? How would she know unless she tried? She repressed a shiver, recalling how constricted and cold she had felt the first time she had dropped into the dark depths. Then she moistened her lips and let herself merge with the green and black and slide into the gray foundation walls and northward, trying to gauge her depth below ground, by a vague feeling, because she could not see, only sense. The greenish-black lines or pathways seemed to branch, one heading westward toward the great piers and the river. Recalling how the water weakened her talent, she followed the branch eastward, which seemed to track, roughly, the preserve. That made her more comfortable, despite the chill that crept into her body and bones, because she'd been able to sense the greenish-blackness on her more recent rides through the preserve, a protected expanse of woods that bordered the banks of the Vedra and stretched a good 20 vaunts northeast from the palace. She was only guessing, but she thought she sensed the riverside hills that marked the northeastern end of the preserve, and she willed herself upward, trying to sense her way to the clearing on the northernmost hill, from where she could see the river. As soon as she emerged from the ground, she raised her talent shields. She'd learned the hard way that she couldn't travel the darkness holding shields, or use shields and a concealment screen, but she didn't want to stand unprotected in the darkness, even if the preserve was supposed to be restricted to her use and that of those she permitted there. She turned to the north, then glanced overhead. Astarta was a full but small green disk, not quite at its zenith, while Selina, the larger and golden-white moon, had just risen above the trees to the east. To the north, as she had hoped, was the silvered expanse of the river Vedra. "I can travel the darkness farther than just Tempra. I can." Her smile faded as, to her right, she heard a rustling, then sensed two figures walking along the riding path leading to the clearing. Both carried bows slung over their shoulders.
Poachers. Who else would be out there in the darkness?
"What are you doing here?" she asked, turning to face them and drawing strength from the green beneath the ground and letting it carry her voice. Both men stiffened, but kept moving toward her.
"Be meaning no one harm,"
offered the smaller man, whose scraggly beard dangled above a ragged tunic, damp in places, doubtless from brushing against wet vegetation. The taller man, a giant more than half a yard taller than Mykella, stepped forward.
"Might be asking you that as well, little woman."
He stopped a yard from her, peering at her.
"Pretty little thing you are."
"You don't belong here,"
repeated Mykella, strengthening her shields. She hadn't brought weapons, and she really had no way to stop the men short of killing them.
"Poaching in the preserve is forbidden."
Even as she spoke, she realized the naivete of her words.
"Now, now, the Lord Protector, he wouldn't be bothering himself over a red deer or so. Even if he did, he wouldn't be missing a deer or two now and again."
The poacher's huge hands reached to grasp her by the shoulders, tightening around the shield she held close to her, and still lifting her, but only for a moment before her shielded figure slipped from his grip. Off balance, she staggered, then stumbled backwards and landed on her buttocks and lower back, still within her shields. She immediately scrambled to her feet. Both angry and embarrassed, she strengthened her ties to the greenness deep beneath the ground and focused light around her, enough so that she could see the startled expression on the face of the bigger man and even on the smaller black-bearded poacher as well.
"You don't belong here," she said coldly. "If you don't turn and leave, you will never leave. Not alive."
With that, she drew on the greenness slightly more, so that her entire body rose from the ground, and her eyes were level with those of the poacher.
"The preserve belongs to the Lady Protector and the Ancients.
Both men backed away, slowly, then more quickly. In moments, both were almost running. Mykella let herself drop slowly until her boots touched the loosely packed damp soil and grass of the clearing. She took a last look at the Vedra, a shimmering, silvery strip under the light of Selena, then reached down to the darkness. She eased her way through the chill and the granite of the palace walls until she was back in the study. Her tunic was edged in frost, and she was shivering. After several moments, she walked toward the bedchamber. She could already feel the soreness in her lower back and buttocks. She'd definitely have a large bruise there. The talent shields might keep her from being struck directly, but she was so small, and her skin was so sensitive, that falling would end up bruising her as much as getting hit would. Her shields would keep her from getting killed, but the way the night had gone, she could easily end up bruised all over her body. She'd have to figure out some way to anchor the shields to something, or they wouldn't be nearly as useful as she'd hoped.
Nothing is as simple as you think. Nothing.
She undressed methodically and pulled on a nightdress, then climbed under the covers, still shivering occasionally. As she began to drift off to sleep, another thought slipped into her mind. Had Mykell the Great laid out the preserve because of the greenish-black pathways? He'd never hunted, according to all the histories. She had to get some sleep, and she pushed that thought away and closed her eyes. 5. Immediately after breakfast on Octi, Mykella walked down to the main level of the palace, all too conscious of the soreness on her backside and of southern guards who followed her as she made her way to the lower accounting chambers, although the palace was not yet open to outsiders. When she walked into the large main floor room, Haylet, the graying clerk in charge of the other clerks, bowed.
Lady Protector.
Mykella could feel his apprehension even before she spoke.
Haylet, I have not forgotten all the years you have served faithfully.
She smiled.
And yet I must ask more of you. Will you take up the duties and the stipend of the chief clerk?
I would be honored, lady.
After the slightest hesitation, he asked,
Maximt?
The former chief clerk of the finance ministry left rather precipitously. For the time being, I serve as my own finance minister.
She turned, and her eyes fell on the red-haired youth who was the most junior clerk.
As I believe you once murmured you wished, Wastol.
The young clerk paled. Mykella smiled at him warmly.
Others might have held it against you. I do not, but you should be aware that anything you say might be heard and repeated.
Then she turned back to Haylet.
You will need to find two more clerks, I think. If you will walk with me back to my study, we can discuss those matters. I will need to provide you with the chief clerk's key and signet, and a letter of passage that you can use until all the guards know you have access to the upper level.
Yes, lady.
No one whispered a word as Haylet and Mykella left the accounting chamber. Once they were outside in the corridor and walking toward the center stone staircase to the upper level, Haylet turned to Mykella.
Lady, I never expected.
I know, but you are accurate and trustworthy, and I value both. Can Viam take your place as assistant chief clerk? Should he, now that Minister Porifer has resigned?
He is very accurate and most scrupulous in his duties, lady. He served under both Lord Porifer and Old Lord Kuarilt.
Mykella sensed no reservations behind Haylet's words.
Then he will succeed you. Do you know who could take Shenel's place handling the Southern Guard accounts? Or should I ask Commander Erased for a recommendation from among his clerks?
If he would part with Janera, she is most accurate.
Mykella repressed a smile. She hadn't known that there was a woman clerking for the Southern Guards.
Tell me about her.
She started up the steps.
Her uncle was Major Olaher, and she began by keeping the accounts for his battalion in Supat. For several years, she dressed as a youth, and no one questioned. When the Major returned to Tempra, Commander Nefrit commended her work, not knowing Janera was a young woman. She was listed as Janar on the pay list. Then he found out and made an order that in the future no women were to be clerks. She was moved to procurement accounts after the Major's death. After your father's death, the Commander said she would be terminated, but Commander Erased stopped that. Still...
Mykella suspected the reason why Nefrit hadn't acted sooner was because the Major's daughter, Irania, had been the mistress of Mykella's father.
It might be better for Janera and the Finance Ministry if she became one of your clerks.
She is a good clerk.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.